black popular psychologist. He's been on a lot of like 7 AM, black film, Hidden Colors 1, 2, and 3. There's another one that I saw where the Hebrew Israelites, can't think of the name of that one. But with warm greetings, please put your hands together and greet Dr. Umar Johnson.
It's an honor to be back in Atlanta, Georgia. I want to get right into my message this evening, brothers and sisters, and I want to start with the children. I want to start with special education. As you all know, many of you, every Tuesday morning, I host a free Black Parent Teleconference, every Tuesday. Parents can call in from anywhere in the world and ask questions about their children. Well, during last week's call, a parent brought up a question. And she wanted to know how she could advocate for her 7-year-old who was in first grade and diagnosed with both a learning disability and subsequently ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. I'm bringing this up because I get very angry and upset. I understand our parents don't know, but I need you parents to start being a little bit more suspicious of anything the school system suggests you do with your children. I've told you, ADHD does not exist. ADHD is a lie. ADHD is a con game. ADHD is a disorder that came to us in 1980. Attention Deficit Disorder, ADD, 1980. Is that a coincidence? Of course not. 1980 was the same year when the CIA dropped crack cocaine off in the black community. And by virtue of eliminating the industrial building trade programs in our comprehensive high schools, many black men were forced to participate in the illegal drug trade, not because they wanted to, but the programs that allowed them to be carpenters and barbers and auto mechanics and plumbers and electricians were removed from the high school. So because there was no more of an industrial base, crack became the economy. Millions of black men sent off to prison for nonviolent drug-related offenses. Millions of black mothers at home left to raise the boys on their own. Because a mother's job is to love. And because a mother's job is to nurture, and because a mother's job is to support, women don't naturally look to discipline their children. That's not her role. But when the daddy is not there, the discipline begins to lack. And so they created a disease called fatherlessness, and they remixed it into ADHD. All ADHD is fatherlessness. That's why I refer to it as ain't no daddy at home disorder. Fatherlessness, ADHD. So mothers and grandmothers, slow down. Don't let the school dictate to you. I want you to know today that you have a right to say no. Did you know that you have a right to say no? Did you know that special education was your prerogative? Did you know that an ADHD evaluation is your prerogative? Did you know that giving your children psychiatric medication is your prerogative? So I need you to start saying no. And under no circumstances, because some of you may have actually drunk the Kool-Aid. Some of you believe in ADHD. Some of you believe in conduct disorder. Some of you believe in emotional disturbances. Some of you believe in Ritalin. Some of you believe in Adderall. Some of you believe in Vyvanse. Some of you believe in Strattera. Some of you believe in Concerta. But do me this favor, even if you believe in this Eurocentric nonsense, do not allow a third grader, a second grader, a first grader, a kindergartner, or a preschooler to be evaluated or placed in special ed or evaluated, diagnosed with ADHD and placed on medication. Don't do that to your child. Nothing good comes from psychiatric brain drugs. If crack is no good for you, Ritalin is no good for your child. They are one and the same. No difference. The Drug Enforcement Agency of America classifies Ritalin as a Schedule II drug. That means Ritalin is just as addictive and dangerous as cocaine and opium. If you don't believe me, go to the library tomorrow. In fact, go to the DEA's website tonight when you get home. Dr. Johnson says something tonight. He said that the Drug Enforcement Agency, which is a branch of the Federal Bureau, a bureau agency, a federal government agency, Dr. Johnson said that the DEA classifies Ritalin in the same category as cocaine and opium. Anything I say tonight, brothers and sisters, do your research. You don't have to walk out of here and swallow nothing you hear. When I tell you that AIDS was invented to get rid of black people, don't believe me. Do the research. I met with Dr. Boyd Graves, the homosexual military officer. We met in Harlem at the National Black Theater in the year 2000. A few years before the FBI killed him. He published a book that you need to read called State Origin. Make sure you read State Origin, a blue floppy book. It looks like a workbook, it's floppy, but it's blue. And it's called State Origin by Dr. Boyd Graves. A black homosexual who contracted AIDS and decided to research the origin of the disease he was carrying. And in doing his research, it led him straight to the United States Library of Congress. And in the United States Library of Congress, he found documented evidence, conclusive proof that the United States government had been experimenting with biological weapons for African population reduction. He found out that half the cancers black people catch were developed by accident on the way to making AIDS. He found out that the AIDS research went back to the 1930s. Boyd Graves was about to take the United States government to world court. Genocide, crimes against humanity. And the CIA and FBI found out about this, and they murdered the brother. It ain't no need to kill a liar. You only kill bringers of truth, brothers and sisters. You only kill bringers of truth. But where does all this come from? AIDS and Ebola, special ed and ADHD. It comes from eugenics. What is eugenics? White racism. The word eugenics was coined by a white psychologist, Francis Galton, in Europe. The word means good stock. The concept means systematically breed white people for supremacy and systematically depopulate the world of African people. He said that black folks are genetically and intellectually retarded, that you are half monkey, that you evolved. Because remember, the white man believes we come from animals. I would agree on his part, he does come from animals. And you have too many black people who want to argue with white people about where the hell they come from. Who are you to tell a white man he don't come from a gorilla? Who are you to tell a white man he don't come from a a chimpanzee? I'm speaking of the theory of evolution. The theory of evolution is that the modern white man evolved from an uncivilized beast in the jungle. If you look at his behavior, it makes sense. If you look at his inhumanity, it makes sense. Do you recognize he's the only human being who cannot visit the home of another human being without respecting their laws and without trying to take over their resources? If you disagree with me, show me a group of Europeans who went into Asia, went into Australia, went into North Central South America, went into Africa, went into the Caribbean, and had the humanity to respect the rules of the peoples whose home they visited, and had the self-restraint not to steal. Brothers and sisters, special education would not even exist if we didn't fight for our kids to sit next to white ones. The learning disability would have never been created had it not been for school desegregation. Do you realize the learning disability was invented in Chicago the same year that the Civil Rights Bill was passed, 1964? White folks said, we got trouble. Thurgood Marshall and Charles Hamilton Houston are making trouble in D.C. They're about to force the Supreme Court to let white kids sit next to black children. So we got to come up with a resegregation strategy. Somebody said, I got it. Psychologist out of Chicago. He said, listen, let's come up with this learning disability. And then the white teacher, the principal, can take the black kids back out of the class and put them in a segregated room all over again. All they have to do is say that they're learning disabled. And many of you here have been hustled and fooled by Georgia schools into believing that your child is learning disabled. Let me tell you what's wrong with your child. The first thing wrong with your child is probably you. I'm saying that because I know children don't drop out of school until parents drop out of their lives. I know that if a parent values education, so will the child. I know that discipline does start at home. I know that if your parents don't make you do homework, you're not likely to value education. I know in some homes we have black fathers who allow their sons to worship sports without worshiping their future. I know that we have some mothers who allow their daughters to spend their whole life looking cute as opposed to trying to do something for their future. So problem number one is you and what they call a specific learning disability is usually nothing more than a sloppy and lazy as hell disability. Your child can learn, he's lazy. Your daughter can learn, she's sloppy. And because you are sloppy and lazy like your child, you'd rather put them in special ed than make their asses do their work. Sometimes I have to ask for a recess at the IEP. Excuse me, white people, I would like to take this Negro parent in the hall for 5 seconds. Do you know what you're about to do? Your son is 9 years old in the fourth grade. If they put him in special ed, I want you to know that he's not likely to be academically functional when he graduates. I also want you to know that under the new special ed law, your child will 95% likely not receive a high school diploma. I hope y'all heard me. Special ed children do not receive automatic diplomas like they did when you and I went to school. I graduated in 92. You could just show up, and if you were special ed, you got a regular diploma even if you couldn't read or write. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of y'all was in there. Well, guess what? George Bush changed the game in 2001. And now, even the special children are expected to do as well as the regular children. Can somebody help me understand? How can a child receiving an inferior education do as well as a child in regular education? How does that even add up? But let's go a step further. The average reading level of a black man in America's prisons is third grade. The average grade at which a black boy is put in special ed is third grade. Do you know what the IEP is? The IEP is an incarceration education program. It prepares your son to go to jail. And guess which disability is the most dangerous of them all? Not autism, not learning disability, not ADHD, not conduct disorder, not speech and language, not deafness, not blindness, not multiple disabilities, not developmental delay, not mentally gifted. The most dangerous diagnosis of them all is serious emotional disturbance. Parents, listen to me. Never allow your child to be evaluated for a serious emotional disturbance. Do you know why? Because that label is reserved for black boys for whom the school district expects them to do nothing with their life except get killed or go to jail. And once you are diagnosed with serious emotional disturbance, they put you in a special class with other throwaway boys. You simply show up, watch TV, play on your cell phone, eat lunch, and go to hell home. And they hope you don't come back. Wow, Dr. Johnson, well, how do I know if that's what they want to do with my son? How do I know if they want to diagnose him with ED? I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to tell you how you know. If you ever get a phone call, if you ever get a letter, listen to me, parents. If you ever get a phone call, if you ever get a letter saying we are asking your permission to evaluate Umar for behavioral or emotional problems, whenever the school requests consent for an evaluation based on emotions or behavior, you automatically know that they want to diagnose your son with an emotional disturbance, because that is the only label of the 13 that speaks to emotions and behavior. I need y'all to be clear. That's the only label. Well, they wanted to see if he had emotional problems. That's the only label. They wanted to see if he had psychological problems. That's the only label. Never let them do the eval if they talk about that. Furthermore, if you can afford to pay a private black school psychologist to evaluate your child, if you really feel something wrong, pay for it out of pocket, brothers and sisters. You get what you pay for. Yes, it's true. You can get a free eval from the school. Yes, it's true. You don't have to pay for it. But I'm going to tell you, as a school psychologist, the quality and the time they spend with your child doing a free eval is nothing compared to the thorough process that we go through when we evaluate your child privately. You tell me your daughter got a speech problem. If you can afford it, find a private speech therapist to do the therapy. Don't let Atlanta Public Schools do the therapy, because she ain't gonna never get no therapy. You ever notice how the black speech kids continue to stutter their whole life? Still got articulation errors after 12 years of speech therapy. You know why? because the speech therapist who's supposed to see your child for an hour a week saw that child for 5 minutes. Wrote up their note like they was with them the whole hour. And you're scratching your head saying these notes look like you're working with my baby, but she still got an articulation error. That's because they're not working with your baby. So the first rule of evaluating children is better to pay for it out of pocket than let the schools do it. Why? Because schools have an ulterior motive. Special ed is a business. Special education is a racket. Special education is a hustle. The minute I diagnose your child, the school district gets twice the money. In Atlanta, children get on average $8,000 per school year spent on their learning. $8,000 if you're regular. But the minute Dr. Johnson says he's LD, he's ADHD, he's autistic, he's retarded, he's deaf, he has a brain injury, he has an orthopedic impairment, the name goes into a computer, it goes to the State Department of Education of Georgia. And by the end of the month, your son's school gets a welfare check. A welfare check for special ed. Isn't it funny how they talk about black people abusing welfare? Do you realize the schools get more welfare money than you ever could get? You need to understand. Parents, stop going to the school by yourself. Stop going to the school by yourself. Well, I'm not scared of them white people. I don't need nobody to go with me. That's exactly why you need somebody to go with them. Because you're gonna get upset and you're gonna get angry, black father. And the minute you show signs of anger, guess what the white teacher gonna do? She's gonna jump under the table on your ass and say, oh my God. The vein in his forehead got very large and his pupils dilated and my heart began to beat and I feared for my safety. And you're gonna say, I didn't threaten you, miss. I know you didn't, but your demeanor shifted. And now you get your restraining order. Never allowed to go back to your child's school again because you went by yourself. I won't even go to the school by myself for my daughters. It ain't no who I am, because I don't want no restraining order. Black men, they are restraining and ordering black men out of schools all across this country. Stop going alone. Bring your brother, bring your nephew, mothers, bring somebody with you. And for the women, I prefer you bring a male. I know my feminist sisters got a problem, I said that. Okay? Because y'all don't need a man for nothing. I understand. I understand. But the reason I want mothers to bring a man with them is because sometimes you are confronting men. And sometimes they like to try to disrespect female energy when she ain't being backed up by some masculine energy. So mothers, bring somebody with you. I don't care if it's the corner boy selling weed. Tell John, John, get your ass in the school. Bring a brother with skinny jeans on. I got an email last week from one of our homosexual brothers. He said, Dr. Johnson, I follow your work, brother. I support you. I've donated to the school. I'm homosexual, but I would like to teach at FDMG. Why would you discriminate against me? Are you saying I have no place? I said, here's the issue, brother. Human beings are creatures of energy. I don't have to tell you what Dr. Umar Johnson believes. 5 minutes around me, you will have a pretty good inclination of what the hell I live for. You understand me? If I let a homosexual male go amongst our boys, he never has to say he's gay. That's right. but his energy will non-verbally communicate to our sons that he is of another persuasion. The brother said, well, I'm a nationalist. I'm a Pan-African nationalist, a gay nationalist. I said, well, I don't have a problem with the fact that you want your own nation for gay people. In fact, I will help you get your own nation for gay people. I have no problem with you all congregating as a family in your own state. In fact, I'm writing a letter to Obama tomorrow. Please give them a state. Because if they had their own state, the heterosexuals wouldn't have to go through what we go through. We wouldn't have to worry about being called homophobic because we disagree with the behavior. We don't have to be charged with hate crimes because we disagree with the lifestyle. We don't have to worry about our kids being brainwashed into gay life in public school. So guess what? If you are a gay nationalist and an advocate of an independent gay republic in these United States, I will be the first to sign your petition. But I love my homosexual and lesbian brothers, even though I disagree with their lifestyle. Because I'm a therapist at heart. And having been doing therapy for almost 20 years, I've come across far too many cases of homosexual black men who came into that lifestyle not because they were born that way, not because of anything other than childhood molestation. I've worked with too many lesbian black women who came to the lifestyle by virtue of the way that they were treated or mistreated or saw their mothers treated or mistreated or by way of sexual abuse. So I can't beat them down, brothers and sisters. I'm not going to hate them. No, I won't do that. Because I understand where the illness comes from. I know where it comes from. See, let's understand something. The reason we have this problem in the first place is because some people have no business living with ICE people. Once upon a time, God created a group of people called the Sun People. They lived under the sun. The sun provided them with everything they needed. If they got hungry, fruit fell from the tree. If they needed vegetation two or three times a year, it would pop up from the ground beneath them. If they needed fresh rainwater or drinking water, they could go and get it. If they needed clothing, there was animals that they could get that from and plants to make it. Because the sun was abundant, it provided the Sun People with abundance. And so Sun People developed a psychology that was based on sharing. Sun People developed a psychology based on taking care of other people. Sun People developed a psychology of love and collectivism. Why? They didn't need to steal nothing because the sun would give it back if it ran out. They didn't need to control no resources because the sun would give them more if it exhausted itself. These people lived communally. They didn't have to lock their doors. They didn't have to worry about stealing because they were people under the sun. The most egalitarian human beings you can ever find. They never learned to be scared. They never learned to hate. They never learned to harm people. If they wanted it, they prayed for it. And most of the time they didn't have to pray for it because it was already there. The Sun People. They lived in harmony with nature, the Sun People. They believed that men should be with women and women should be with men, the Sun People. They had no concepts of feminism. They had no concepts of homosexuality. They had no concepts of anything that was anti-nature because the Sun People were a nature-based people. But there was another group of people called ICE people. They didn't have no damn son. Truth be told, they didn't have no damn soap either. Sun people lived under the cold. It always was cold. Nothing grew from the trees. Nothing sprouted from the ground. They lived in caves, under rocks, and in the soil that they did have, it never produced anything because it wasn't nutrient rich. So sun people developed the psychology of always having to manipulate other people to get what they needed, because they did not eat unless they stole it from someone who had. They developed a psychology of trickery, because the only thing that they could provide was what they could hoist from others. In fact, ICE people had no system of family, because they didn't know whether they would live another day or not. And if they got too hungry, they didn't go hunting, because there was nothing to hunt. They had to kill and eat each other. ICE people could not live in harmony with nature. Why? Because nature did not provide for them. How do you expect me to respect the sun? The sun never gave to us like it gave to the sun people. How do you expect me to respect the moon? You tell me to reverence the hurricane and the tornado and the thunderstorm. We can't! Because the forces of nature never blessed the people of the ice. And so one day, the ice people wandered out of their caves, and they came into the land of the sun people. And they walked right up and said, look at this shit here. They got diamonds in the damn water. Kids is climbing up eating coconuts. Elvis over there got barbecue. Chitlins. Honey baked yams. And the ice people got jealous of the sun people. They said, we've been suffering like this 5,000 years, and these people got the audacity to be living like this? Oh, hell no. Guess what we're going to do? We're going to take and steal and kill and manipulate, and we're not going to feel sorry for none of these sun people, because they never had it like we had it. And we're going to give them a taste of what the hell we had to go through. In fact, we're going to make their hell 50 times worse than ours. But the sun people didn't understand it, because your heart was so good and so pure. When you saw the ice people, they came in smelling like dog mess. You gave them some black soap and took them to the river to wash his ass. And when he was done washing at the river, you brought him some shea butter. And you know how y'all love shea butter. Yeah, strawberry shea butter, pineapple shea butter, rum raisin shea butter. You gave him a haircut. You taught the women how to take care of themselves when they monthly came. You treated them like family. And guess what? The better you treated them, the more jealous they became of you. In fact, they began to have a contempt of the sun people. Because after all, people without anything hate to feel indebted to somebody who can give them something. So the more you helped, the more they strategized to hurt. And they took over the land of the sun. And they still taking over the land of the sun. And the ancestors sent me here today to tell you sun people in here, stop acting like you come from the goddamn ice. You sun people, we got a certain way of living, a certain way of acting, a certain way of feeling, a certain way of praying, and a certain way of making. And we don't let nobody come and tell us how to operate our communities. Brothers and sisters, I know we've been raised not to hate. And I want you to continue not to hate. But please don't confuse not hate was not accepting the reality that there are people who exist who are nothing like you, want nothing to do with you, and will kill their own children to get rid of you. We're the only people made to feel ashamed of being for ourselves. And you got Negroes running around talking about slavery over. Stop talking about it. It ain't over. In fact, slavery is only 150 years old. You say, what do you mean, Doc? We've been free for 150, right? 1865, 2015, that's 150. Wrong. I would argue psychologically that slavery did not start until 1865. And I argue that, brothers and sisters, because if I am a slave, you do not have to put me in handcuffs. If I am a slave, you do not have to beat me. If I am a slave, you don't have to cut off my feet. If I'm a slave, you don't have to brand me with your name. A slave willingly submits. A free man has to be forced. So from the time we got here until 1865, that was free black people. The niggas came in 1865. Well, I don't know about that, Doc. I might be the exception. Because everybody's the exception. Have you noticed that? Black people, I was talking about, yeah, black people don't want to do no better. They never talk about they said, yeah, black people don't want to see other black. It ain't me, the man with hating. Talk about what other black people don't want to see black people do. You tell me you're not a slave? What did you buy for Christmas, and who did you buy it from? So much. You love to see them successful so much that you will see your children live in poverty so your master can live in the suburbs. Brothers and sisters, most of what you own in your house, you bought it not because you needed it. And you didn't buy it because it was quality. You bought it because it had a famous white person's name attached to it. That Louis Vuitton pocketbook, they sell them under four different names. Same pocketbook. The one that say Louis cost $500, but you can get the same pocketbook in a regular boutique shop for $50, but it don't say Louis Vuitton. Them same Air Jordans you can buy from Payless, the same sneaker from the same factory for $25. The quality is no different. Why did you pay $200 instead of $25 from Payless? It's the same sneaker, same factory. Because you paid for Air Jordan's name.
Bring it up, Doc. Bring it up.
And you say slavery over? In slavery, we had to walk around with our slave master's name tattooed on our body with a branding iron. And now you voluntarily brand your own self with white people's names and got a note to tell me you're free. And then you turn around and say, Dr. Johnson, you opening a school, but you're telling me my son got to live on campus to go to your school. I don't understand that. You know why? Because you're sick. And if I want to make your son free, I got to get him away from you sometimes. Listen. Listen. In psychology, what's the first thing they teach about psychopathology? They teach that all mental illness comes from the family. Mm. If you got low self-esteem, let's look at your parents. You an alcohol addict, let's look at your parents. You a sex addict, we can trace the etiology to your house. Do you think only low self-esteem comes from the home? Anxiety disorders come from the home? Bipolar come from the home? Post-traumatic slavery disease comes from the home. And if I'm gonna free your sons, I got to separate them away from you. Why? Because the Willie Lynch conditioning process is operating in your house. Let's talk about Willie Lynch for a minute. Some people talk about he didn't exist. He may not have. And guess what? I don't even care. The science of the Willie Lynch letter is 100% right and exact. Half the stories in the Bible didn't exist. But they still tell a profound truth. Do you realize as African people, we invented what is known as the parable? White people call it the fairy tale. Well, Dr. Johnson, if black people believe in truth, why do we invent lies to tell stories? Because our ancestors recognize that sometimes the best way to communicate a truth is through a made-up story. So I don't get caught up into the truthfulness of Willie Lynch. I'm only looking at the science. Yes. Willie Lynch told slave masters a lot of things to do, but there was three in particular to which I want to direct your attention that are especially relevant for me as a psychologist. Number one, Willie Lynch said, if you want to rule your niggas for the rest of the millennium, you can control them until the day you die. The first thing you need to do is make sure you take their native tongue from them and only let them communicate through your tongue. Why? Why did Willie Lynch said they gotta speak the slave master's language? Why can't they still speak Zulu or Twi or Hausa or Igbo? What difference does it make? Because Willie Lynch understood language is one of the most powerful identifiers of culture. He said it will be hard for them to remain slaves if they speak the language of their ancestors. Because when you have your own tongue, it's a constant reminder that you are free. That's why they want your kids to speak standard English. It ain't got nothing to do with being educated. It's about making sure you identify with your oppressor. It's about making sure that when you tell your story must always be trapped in the vernacular of your enemy. The reason is so white people can always know what you are talking about. Do you realize we're the only people in America who cannot have a private conversation in front of white people? Mexicans, they don't like white folks, they start talking Mexican right in front of them. When Hanafi and Balawi from Iraq, in front of the white folks, they don't like it, they start hashishing all day. Chinese will flip out real quick and go into their own dialogue. Black people trap. That's why Fred Douglas, Marcus Garvey Academy, we're gonna teach your children how to speak a few African languages. Indigenous tongue. I had a Negro email me last month. Doc, aren't you gonna teach them Spanish? You know a lot of people speak Spanish. Really? Okay. Are you aware that there's more Nigerians in Nigeria who speak Igbo in Yoruba than there are Spaniards in Spain? So why don't we teach Igbo or Yoruba? It ain't got nothing to do with how many people speak in Spanish. It's because white people value white culture and they despise black folk, and the reason they teach black kids white languages and not African language, because the belief is if you're a black child graduating from Atlanta Public School, if they're going to be successful in life, chances are they will not be doing business with anyone who speaks an African language. It's racism, brothers and sisters. It's racism. It's nothing worse when I see African immigrant children come to America and they need language services in public school and they don't have language services for Ghanaian kids and Liberian kids and Congolese children. They got Spanish, they got Greek, they got Mandarin, they got Chinese, they got Arabic, but not a single African language do they have services for in most American public schools. It ain't about culture, it's about racism. So Willie Lynch said, take the language, give them yours. But the slave masters didn't do a good job of that. They told Willie Lynch to go to hell, we're not educating these Negroes. And Willie Lynch said, you're making a mistake. Because if you don't teach them your language and stop them from speaking theirs, you will never totally acculturate those people. And guess what has happened? 150 years out of slavery, you still speak an African tongue. Mm. Because he did not educate you, he allowed your native language to live on. Our children in Atlanta, they don't speak English, they speak African. They speak Niger Congo dialect. Mm. Well, what do you mean, Doc? They using English words. Yes, words. But you need to understand, when you deal with language, words are only one part of a language. There's the syntax of a language. There's the grammar of a language. There's the morphology of the language. There's the structure of the language. There's the philosophy of the language. The vocabulary words is only one part. You don't believe me that you speak African? Well, then what the hell are you running around talking about so we be fixing to get something for dinner for? What white person you see fixing to do shit, okay? That's African language. Differences between European language, African language. Difference number one, we do not put strong consonant endings on our words. White people, we are about to prepare supper because Jones and his wife are coming over later to watch the ball game. White culture is about the enunciation of every phoneme in every word. Black culture is about a rhythmic expression, not right now. Because our language is rhythm. And that's why white people don't understand it, because our language is rooted in the collectivism of our culture.
Yes.
That means five black people can be standing in a circle, all talking at the same time, understanding each other perfectly, and white people walking and saying, these people are so disrespectful. Look at them, Mark. They're all talking at the same time. White culture is based on hierarchy. It is vertical. African culture is horizontal. So if I'm talking to my brother, another brother can jump right in. White people don't operate like that. They are hierarchy. When one person talks, everyone must shut up because he's probably smarter than the rest of us. Difference number one between white language and African language. Excuse me, number two, that was one. Our language is always and forever in the present tense. White people language is divided into past, present, and future. African people, we are a conscious people, so everything is about the here and now. So when you ask another African, did you do what I asked you to do? He don't say, I completed the task. He says, I got that. He didn't say, I did it. I got it now. Do y'all understand? That's not ignorance. That's your language. If you go with me to Ghana this summer, and we're going for the third time. Last year we went to Egypt and Ghana, had a chance to climb up in the Great Sphinx. But I think I was a little scared of heights. So I'm not gonna tell no lie. I went up half and came down. That's all the whole tapping I could do. And the sisters embarrassed me because they went all the way up to the top of the pyramid and came back down. The queens, I couldn't go no more. Okay, ancestors say, you ain't supposed to go 20 more stories, brother. But we went. And what we saw that we did not like in Kemen was how the Arabs have no respect for African culture. And the only reason why they value the pyramids and the cultural relics is for the money and the commerce and the tourism. We saw one Arab taking a piss in the corner. Man, one of the pyramids. They have no respect for that culture. It was beautiful. We saw the Sphinx and we went to the light show and took a boat ride down the Nile. And it was beautiful, brothers and sisters, but guess what? I'm here to tell you that that was 5,000 years ago. It was beautiful. You should see it. Our children need to see it. But your time is now. We don't need another pyramid. I don't want you building no Sphinx with my face on it. We need institutions. Our people were builders. You are a builder. African people, by DNA, construct things that their people need. We gotta get back to the building of it. But this summer we wanna do Senegal and Ghana. Senegal is very special to Dr. Umar Johnson, because many of you know that I was raised Muslim. And I still adhere to some of the traditions of the religion. I think it can be a beautiful religion when practiced the worship of God. You do not have to dress like there's a sandstorm going around the corner. You understand? I always direct my Muslims to one hadith of the Prophet Muhammad that they always look over. Muhammad said, give the people religion, but do not take their culture. That's right. You don't have to be an Arab to be a Muslim. Go to France. I was in France right after I came from South Africa. You got white Muslims in France. They do not dress like Arabs. They did not change their name. They are white culture practicing Muslims. And you should be an African culture practicing Muslim or Christian. If you Jehovah's Witness, then get you a Hotep watchtower and get that out. My grandmama's a Jehovah's Witness, so I know all about it. But I'm gonna tell you something, black people, we can learn something from them in terms of the way they beat the streets for no recruits. Negroes wanna organize on Facebook. You wanna have an Instagram revolution. Do you see the Jehovah's Witnesses recruiting on Instagram and Twitter? Hell no, they still on the street, still still knocking on your door. And if you slam the door, they come right back with a buttermilk biscuit and a small orange juice. They have mastered the art of smiling at people who are getting on their nerves. You're gonna have to learn how to do the same thing. So brothers and sisters, stop telling our children that they gotta stop speaking broken English. He ain't speaking English anyway. All he's speaking is the English words. His language is African. Now I know we probably got a bourgeois Negro in here or two who's probably said, I can't believe he's telling black people this shit. This shit won't make no sense. Do you know what the bourgeois problem is? They think the white man is against your child because his English is broken. They think the white man is against your child because his pants is sagging. They think the white man is against your child because the father is in jail. They think the white man is against your child because he listens to rap. Guess what? Your son could come from a two-parent home where the mom is a doctor and the daddy a lawyer. They can live in the suburbs. He could wear a suit to work. He can speak perfect English, and the police will still shoot him down like a damn dog in the street. He ain't objected to what the black boy say or wear. He objected to the black boy himself. White people don't like us for what we are, not who we are. You don't believe me? Go ask Bill Cosby. Yeah, we from the same hood in North Philly, but I'm gonna talk about it.
Talk about it.
Here's a black man for the last 20 years made a living defending racism to black people. Yeah. What he say? Get married before you have kids. Stop blaming racism. Make your kids do their homework. Stop blaming racism. Tell them to pull up their pants. Stop blaming racism. And look what happened to him. Yeah. Let me get this right. Bill Cosby's in his 80s, right? Let me get this right. He harasses a white woman, but she don't call the cops. She don't make a report. She don't tell nobody. But don't get me wrong. I do not trivialize abuse against women, regardless of color. But I understand that the white woman benefits from a white privilege, and the black man suffers from a white racism. So if a white woman has the ability to destroy the most popular black entertainer in the world, do you think she's gonna wait 14 years to come out with a story? Not only that, was it just a coincidence that 20 ugly, old, nasty white women all at the same time had a Nirvana experience and contacted the mayor, excuse me, the media, separately? 20 different white women all of a sudden decided to tell on Bill Cosby at the same time. Brothers and sisters, please. That was a damn setup, because Bill was about to make another major move in media, and a white man didn't agree with it, and so they shook his ass. That's what happened to Bill Cosby. But there's a lesson for my bourgeois in the audience, because some of y'all think you can earn your way into white freedom. You think you can move your way into white freedom. You can talk your way into white freedom. You can educate your way. I don't care how long you've been serving your master, if you ever get out of line, he won't hesitate to put you in your place. White supremacy is white supremacy. A lot of y'all got confused when they put Obama in office. Y'all said, wait a minute, Doc, there's a black man in there. You big dummy. White supremacy is not about the color of the leader. It's about the agenda he's carrying out. If the white man thinks he can get further with Ben Carson than Billary, he will make Ben Carson the president. Because it ain't about who you see. It's about who makes the decisions. Obama just signed an executive order. He commuted the sentences, the life sentences, of 100 people in jail. That was cute. That was real cute. That was real cute. Only problem, Obama, there's 40 million black folks in America. So you wanna let some of our brothers and sisters out of jail for selling your government's crap. And the rest of us supposed to be happy. You know what Obama doing right now? He's cleaning up his image for black folks in his last year. So when you call him a sellout, he can say, well, listen, I let 100 black folks out. And what are you supposed to say in response to that? You're supposed to say, sir, if black people are going to do better, things must be done for the group, not individuals inside it. I'm gonna say this again, because a lot of you are getting brainwashed by stuff like LeBron. Y'all getting brainwashed by Oprah. Y'all getting brainwashed by black millionaires and billionaires. You're thinking racism over because they let a few in. Progress is not about Umar Johnson. Progress ain't Barack. Progress ain't Beyonce or Oprah. Progress ain't Condoleezza Rice. Progress is when, as a group, we do better tomorrow than what we do today. That's progress. Bourgeois niggas over. If he uses English words, he's speaking English. So to the bourgeois who are present. Hey, he said spot, I'm right there. I just asked you one question. And you can email me your response. If you're going to argue that black children who use English vocabulary words are in fact speaking English because they only use the words, not the syntax, not the grammar, not the structure, not the morphology, just the vocab, then I'm going to have to argue to you that there's not a white person in America who speaks English, because over 60% of America's vernacular comes from other people's cultures. So take your bougie ass home with yourself. What's the next thing Willie Lynn said? Number two, he said, if you want to rule your Negroes, you must find every superficial petty difference that you can muster and use it as a tool of divide and conquer, separate and rule. Willie said, put the light skin against the dark skin in Atlanta. Willie said, put the Negroes in the Atlanta suburb against the ones in the ghetto. Put the ones who dropped out of high school against the ones with the doctorate. Put the women against the men. Feminism. Put the gays against the straight. Put the Muslims against the Christian. And they will fight like hell. And they will learn to love fighting each other so much they will forget about you altogether. And he said, never think that any petty difference is too small to be made into an issue. Black people have this thing of fighting over anything. Atlanta, you ain't got over your petty differences yet. So I'm gonna answer the holy question. What is the holy question? The holy question is, what is taking so long for black people to solve their problems? You know what's taking so long for black people to solve their problems? Black people have to learn to hate racism more than each other. And until you learn to hate racism more than each other, we ain't never coming out of this. What's the third thing? Ladies, I want you to pay close attention. Willie Lynn said, the most important thing you have to do to control your Negroes is you have to destroy the black woman's natural dependency, respect, and trust for the black man. If you don't believe me, go to the Shrine of the Black Madonna bookstore.
Yes.
It's a few store fronts down, where you should be going anyway. I'll be living in Atlanta, and about a third of my books come from Atlanta Shrine of the Black Madonna bookstore. Put your hands together for the Shrine of the Black Madonna. Pan-African Orthodox Church, Black Christian Nationalist. Get that Willie Lynch letter, and you will see that's exactly what he said. But how did he say this had to be carried out? He said, get all your Negro women and line them up. Get all the Negro children and line them up. And then find the biggest, boldest, blackest, broadest, strongest alpha male in your slave state. Bring that Negro out in front of all the nigger women and all the nigger infants. And he said, beat that black man down to within 2 inches of his life. Don't kill him, but beat him so bad he'll wish he's dead. And the entire time you're beating him, you must make sure his wife and children are watching. He said, then tar and feather that Negro. Tie one leg to one horse facing that direction. The other leg to another horse facing that direction. Beat both horses in opposite directions simultaneously. And those horses will rip the body of the slave in two. And if the black woman sees her man, who she loved, who she trusted, who she depended on, to the level of an infant, she will never trust or depend on him ever again. If the slave children see the biggest, baddest, broadest, blackest slave treated and killed like that, the little black girls will never look to black boys to protect them. But Willie Lynch said the greatest effect of this conditioning machine is the fact that the black woman, being so terrified by what the master just did to a husband, will raise her sons to be cowards out of fear that what happened to daddy would happen to them. So my single black mothers, I love you for the good job you're doing. I need you to do me a favor, mothers, married and single, because some of y'all, when daddy leaves, I got a whole nother training that go on in the house. Don't raise your son to be no coward. God made that boy a man on purpose. And if you don't raise your son to be an unapologetic alpha African male, he will not be able to fulfill his destiny. I know there's a war against unapologetic alpha African males, but I don't give a damn because God made me man. And I refuse to let anyone take my spirit because they don't agree with it. And black man, you remain an alpha man. Don't trade in your regular jeans for skinny jeans. I'm serious, brothers and sisters. Who do they send to jail? Effeminate brothers? Hell no. Alpha men in jail. Who they send to special ed? Effeminate boys? Hell no. Alpha males. Do you realize the entire American society is designed to destroy any black man who shows a lack of fear towards white people? Conduct disorder. That ain't nothing but Caucasian disorder. That's a black boy tired of being mistreated by white folks and decided to tell them how he feels. And they made it a disease. We got some guests in the house, brothers and sisters. We got some guests.
Who we got?
before I get to my guests, let me say this. There's a war against the image of the black family. It ain't just against the man no more. It's against the whole family. It ain't just against black women no more. It's against the whole family. And the number one weapon in this war is your television screen. I remember when Waiting to Exhale came out and we said, damn, look how they beating up on brothers. Color Purple came out, we said, damn, look how they beating up on brothers. Tyler Perry came out with How Did I Get Married, we said, damn, look how he beating up on sisters. Came out with Temptation, look at how they beating up on black women. And then, European came out with Scandal. Okay. Olivia Cole.
Okay.
Number one show for black women in America. In the show where a black woman, beautiful, Kerry Washington, educated, sexy. She a little too thin for me. I don't really like the real small ones. I like a little big. Okay? So small she might break. I don't know. Like an athletic physique. A little bounce on that corner. Like the petite model. I like the little goods with the grip. But anyway, you got a show where the black woman is in love with the married president. Can't stand that dad, can't stand any black man. But she'll sit around and play the whore to the president. Scandal not for you, Scandal not for your children, Scandal. Excuse me, Scandal not for you, Scandal for your children, to condition your sons and your daughters about what black women really about, what black men really about. And let me say this before I go to my first guest. They gave us Empire! Lucius! Only thing I love about Lucius, he don't like white folks. Lucius don't give a damn about white folks. But other than that, you can't stand his baby mama. Can't stand his ex-fiance. Lucius does not like black women or trust him. And he got three sons who he made just like him. Hakeem, Jamal, and Andre. Andre, Ivy League, bourgeois, stiff suit, white wife. Can't stand him, black women. Hakeem, hyper-masculine, hip-hop, thug. Can't stand black women. And then you have Jamal. In love with a white male. Atlanta! I gotta ask you the question, how can you have the number one show in America, even white folks watching, with four not a single one has a positive relationship with a black woman. Brothers and sisters, at this time, I want to introduce a very intelligent brother, very sophisticated brother. I made his acquaintance about a year or two ago. We ran into each other on the airline, and we've been keeping in contact ever since. In fact, sometimes they tell me I look like him. He might have heard he looked like me too. The brother has won a Grammy. He's conscious. He's politically inclined. He's all about our people. Put your hands together for Killer Mike, black family. Where's Killer Mike at? Killer Mike, come on up. Yes, put them hands together, black family. I don't care if you're Christian, Muslim, Moor, Yoruba, Samoa, I love you. So anytime anybody is saying anything about helping black people, I gotta check them out. That don't mean I know. That don't mean I'm the best. That simply means I care for y'all so deeply. That when I see someone else who cares for y'all so deeply, my first instinct is how can I help? We in Atlanta have every type of black person you ever want to meet. Poor, rich, indifferent, learned, unlearned, new Africans, old Africans, Samoa Africans. We got every type of black person you want to meet. And this has been, through all our faults, because we're not perfect, this has been a successful representation for me for what is possible when the African American community works together. I learned as a child that black people can run a city, black people can run their own finance, businesses, banks, black people can control the commerce in their own neighborhoods. And somewhere along the way, even in Atlanta, we lost our way. But I'm here to tell you, I traveled all over the world this year, not last year, not the year before, and again, I'm gonna go. But everywhere in the world I go, there is no place like Atlanta, Georgia. But what scares me is that we are allowing our community to be fragmented. And the reason I started by giving the descriptions of the different type of blacks we are is because if you're a Pan-Africanist, if you really represent the diaspora, meaning everywhere from Africa to Asia to South America, they probably gonna find one of us on Antarctica. Everywhere in the world you go, if there's a black person there, my care and concern has to be with there. So if I'm Muslim in Atlanta, it is my obligation to organize, first and foremost, on behalf of black Christians and Muslims and Hebrews. If I'm Hebrew or Christian, it is my job to make sure when Islam is being attacked that these peaceful Muslims who have lived in Atlanta for over 100 years at this point, in some cases 50, 60 years, that we make sure that they are never misrepresented, they are never bullied, and stupid people like Trump cannot point to them and make them targets in our community. Because we have been sophisticated enough, loving enough, and understanding enough to coexist. So we don't want your democratic problems, we don't want your Republican problems, but we will use our vote as a tool for our own empowerment. We will use our organizational skills for our own empowerment. So what I'm gonna say today is, when I saw Dr. Umar was coming out, I called all my friends that rap. I called them all early in the morning, 7, 8 o'clock.
That's right.
T.I. came out. Prince Si came out. Backbone came out. I didn't call him, but he got an inside line. Usher came out. So the next time you're in a barbershop or a braid shop or a beauty shop and the conversation starts, well, what about those damned entertainers? I want you to say stop. I want you to say stop. Because this event sold out without any of their names. And they came because they were curious as to what you were doing. And based on what they hear tonight, that's going to end up in their songs. So what I want you to do is go away tonight knowing that it doesn't matter what we're labeled. I don't care what you call me, a gangster rapper, as long as you understand I am a Pan-Africanist gangster rapper. I am a bang on the behalf of black people. I don't care what you call me. If you call me a nigga, you better know I'm a badass nigga on the behalf of black people. If you call me a whore, you better know I need more for black people. If you know that I am worshiping Allah or Yahweh or Yahshua, whatever you call it, you better know, first and foremost, I am doing it on the behalf of black people. I had a brother from the conscious community not understand some of my motives. My brother immediately called me a coon. Oh man, I'm talking about, whoa. Boy, he, woo, that man cut me deep. And I understood that I have been there in my development where I thought, if you wasn't with the Nation of Islam, you're wrong. If you wasn't with the black Christians, you're wrong. If you're not with black Nation, you're wrong. What I have learned in my short 40 years on earth is that the African proverb that says many hands make light work never said those hands were all the same. It never said those hands were somehow, they were all the same family, all the same fraternity, all the same. All it said was many hands made for light work. So I need your hand, and your hand, and your hand, and your hand, and some more hands. I don't care what religion you follow. I don't care what lodge you belong to. I don't care what fraternity or sorority. I care that you are black. Nothing else. That has to become the prerequisite for what we do. I'm gonna be honest with you. I'm gonna leave here. I'm gonna smoke a joint. I'm gonna probably end up in one of the numerous strip clubs with my wife. And in those clubs, my wife is gonna say, if you vote, vote on the behalf of black people. And my wife
Terry. And I'm gonna say, if I tip you this money, please go to school, because we need more learned black women. But what I'm not gonna do is judge them, shame them, or talk down. So I'm here tonight.
All right, brother.
Simply because I love black people. I'm about to go. I love you with all my heart. Nothing can change that. I don't care what differences we have. We came here black. We exist while we black. We gonna exit black. So we might as well be black together. I love you. So at this time, brothers and sisters, please put your hands together for your brother, my brother, David!
Sit down, y'all. We don't have much time. We don't have much time. There are a couple of things I want to speak to you about. Killer talked about something that I was gonna touch on, so I don't need to go there. But I wanted to talk about something. It's so amazing. So many things that separate us. But if there's a cop that pulls over a black man, he don't give a damn if you're straight, gay, Moor, Muslim, Christian, whatever the hell you are. They don't care. The one thing they come together about is the death of our people. So at what point do we stop caring about the things that keep us away from each other and think about the one thing, if nothing else, that brings us together, and that's being black people? See, one of the things that happened that he didn't talk about when we were in Brooklyn, we were actually in church, and I asked him something. I said, what is God made out of? And he said, matter. I said, matter? I said, what are all things in the universe made out of? They said, matter.
Peace. How you doing? I'm better now.
So when he said matter, I said, well, if God is all matter, then what are you? You are not a child of God. You are God. We are looking for God. But where?
Inside.
And what? See, usually we say you, and you is still taking the ownership off of yourself. God is not in you, God is in me. And I believe if we started teaching our young children, regardless of what you are, that you are a God, then maybe they would act like gods. And when they saw another black man,
so, that's a misconception about where David Banner being, and I want to, you know, since Atlanta is the place where my career started, I want to clear up some misconceptions about where David Banner did. So, I heard a couple rumors that David Banner fell off. Now, let's be clear about something. I had the number one single in the nation when I stopped rapping, but I want to tell you what happened real quick. I had the number one single with Chris Brown, Get Like Me. I was doing a European tour, and I got an opportunity to see how the world looks at black men, black American men, let's be clear. And at that time, the focus was videos, and at the time, my video was one of the hottest videos at the time, and that was when reality TV shows first started. So they don't get to see our parents. They don't get to see Heal the Hood. They don't get to see Tip giving, how much money? 6 figures. Yeah. They don't see that. They don't see the fact that Jeezy, and I don't even talk about this much, Jeezy came and gave me $20,000 and said, I want you to take this back to Mississippi and give it to your people. And I don't want you to tell no, I don't want you to tell nobody that I gave it, because this ain't about no publicity. This is about us helping our people. And this is, and not because Tip in the building, Tip said something that really, really strengthened me. Tip said, Ben, I'm gonna talk to you about something. He said, what we gonna do? And I said, well, what are we gonna do? And Tip said, lead us. Show us what to do, black man. And we did the number
one urban relief concert in history was here in Atlanta with the Heal the Hood concert.
I'm gonna begin to wind this down, and there's a couple things. Number one, I told you about the Africa tour, but I also want to tell you about the Black Boy College trip. I want you to know that in June, we're taking our little boys, young men, excuse me, from ages 11 to 17 on a Black Boy College tour. There will be one tour in June. There will be a tour in August. In June, the North Tour, which will leave and return from Harlem, and the South Tour will leave and return from here, Atlanta. The North Tour, we will take them to the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, the Audubon Ballroom where Malcolm was assassinated. We will take them to Malcolm's grave, Dr. Yusuf Iyakaden's grave,
yes.
Paul Robeson's grave,
yes.
And Dr. Khaled Abdul Muhammad's grave.
Yes.
We will also take them to the Great Blacks and Wax Museum in Baltimore, Maryland. We will also take them to Coppin State, Bowie State, Morgan State University, the Frederick Douglass House, the new Civil Rights Museum that they're building in DC as well. They will also go to the Nat Turner Trail. For those of you who don't know, Nat Turner led the bloodiest slave revolt in American history, August the 21st of 1831 or 1832. Your son will relive that trail, relive that experience. It's very important. Some of the homes where the war took place still stand. Make a donation to GoFundMe.com. Please make that donation. Make that donation, brothers and sisters. Get us that school. $500,000 in a year, I'm thankful, I'm humbled, I'm proud that y'all gave me that. But you just spent $3 billion on Christmas. We should have that school by now. For those of you who want to work at the school, send me your resume. FDMGResumes@gmail.com. Appreciate you, my brother. I only ask that you meet two requirements if you're going to work at my school. You all know I'm a Garveyite. That's what I stand for. I'm a pan-Africanist. I am not a love-everybody black man. I am not. Okay? Pan-Africanist, we believe that all African people are one family. We believe that we should identify as being African before we identify as being anything else. You're not a Christian who happens to be black. You're a black man who happens to be a Christian. Being African comes first. As pan-Africanists, we believe that in order to solve our problems, all African people globally must rise at once. Why is black America still fighting racism? Because you're fighting by yourself. Why is black Europe? I was in Manchester in September. I was the keynote speaker in Manchester, England for the 70th anniversary of the 1945 5th Pan-African Congress. Why is there still racism in England? They fighting by themselves. I just got invited to go to Australia a few days ago. They still fighting racism. Jamaica fighting racism. Why? Because we want to fight as a tribe instead of a people. As Pan-Africanists, we believe that all Africans will rise together at once, or none of us will rise at all. Your enemy is global. White supremacy is global. So guess what? Your strategy must be global as well.
That's right.
We won't fix this until North Atlanta stands with South Atlanta. Muslim stands with the Christian. Light skin with the dark skin. Until black men realize that you cannot fight unless you're fighting alongside a black woman. We are unapologetic in our respect for black women. A black man who is not with a black woman is going to have a hard time convincing me he's a black man.
Wow.
I'm serious about that. Too many black women are made to feel insecure and inferior because of the black man's lust for the white man's trophy. We do this together. That's right. I'm an educator. I'm a school psychologist. I'm a clinical doctor. You're not there when the little girls are asking Dr. Umar why does successful black men only want to run to a white woman for his mate. And why do I disagree with interracial marriage so much? I don't hate nobody. I help white kids, Chinese kids, but I love my own first. And nobody gonna tell me that I don't have a right to love mine first. that's what being unapologetically African is all about. The black woman ain't perfect, the black man ain't perfect. If she could put up with you, brother, with all your imperfections, you should be able to put up with hers. I'm tired of little black girls being made to feel inferior. Brother, don't pick on the sister for her hair not being natural. You know why it's not? She's trying to look like what you looking for. Let's be honest about that. She's trying to look like what you looking for. That's why she processed.
That's right.
Bring it up.
But ladies, I will say though, at the Fred Douglas Marcus Garvey Academy, if you're going to work at my school, if your daughter is going to come to the Anna Douglas Amy Garvey Academy, she has to come 100% nappy by nature, or she cannot come at all. That is my standard. And I will not equivocate. I will not equivocate. I'm getting sick and tired of black women spending the greater portion of their disposable income on so-called beauty products, killing themselves to look like a European. Black women have the fastest growing rate of brain cancer.
Tell it.
Black women have the fastest growing rate of brain cancer. Do you know why?
Tell it.
Because the materials in the relaxer, the chemicals in the perm system, is seeping through your skull.
Yes.
And it is causing toxic side effects in your skull bone. I'm running into women every month who had to get pieces of a skull taken out and replaced with steel plate because of cancer in the skull. I read an article the other day that they are now connecting the perm and the weave because the chemicals in the weave are almost as toxic as the chemicals in the perm. And they now tying that to fibroids and breast cancer. So I ain't here to knock none of my sisters who not natural. I still love you, as Mike said, you still our sisters. But I do want you to change that hair for the sake of your health.
Yes.
And don't worry, if you forget to bring your daughter to school on the first day with a natural, with a naturally natural head, I am a barber. I cut it. And I will give her a baldy locks if you forget the brand. Natural. So brothers and sisters, that's the college tour. The Africa trip will be the last week of July, first week in August. It's always the same. Last week in July, first week in August, the Africa trip is about $4,000. I don't make any money on that either. The travel agent does, though. But I don't. Okay? I will have information for all of that on my website, drumarjohnson.com. Also, if you're on social network, you can link with me, Dr. Umar Johnson, on Twitter, at Dr. Umar Johnson on Instagram. And I use my Yoruba last name on Facebook. So it's Dr. Umar Ifatunde on Facebook. If you need to email me, drumarjohnson@yahoo.com. I'm also working on a Caribbean cruise for the summer. Haiti, Jamaica, and Mexico. We're going to go to Marcus Garvey's gravesite, Nanny of the Maroons' gravesite, that bold black woman who never equivocated to the British. Old black woman who never gave up. She forced them to sign a treaty, and the people of Moortown in Jamaica today are still free. They don't even pay taxes. We're going to take you to the Bob Marley grave, Bob Marley Museum. Go get some of that good Jamaican seafood. Get in one of those naturally hot Jamaican springs. Watch yourself now. Being a scandal. We want to go to Haiti and visit the revolutionary heritage of Haiti and finish up in Mexico where our ancestors went and civilized the people there and built the pyramids, the Olmec civilization. So you can go to the Caribbean, you can go to Africa, you can do both. If you've never been out the country, go to Africa first. Always go home first. Or you might be able to do both. That's how we won't pop. Brothers and sisters, as I bring this to a close, I want to say that our brothers and sisters in South Africa want you to come visit. I was there for a month last month. End of October, early November. I went to Durban, Cape Town, Johannesburg, Soweto. Our brothers and sisters are not too happy with Nelson Mandela down there. They feel he pulled a Barack Obama on them. And he did. Okay? But I still respect the man for the good he did as a youth. And it's important that we don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. Sometimes we can be too critical of black leadership. Give him a chance sometimes. So we're working on an international Pan-African conference in Johannesburg. Hopefully summer of 2017. So start saving your money for that. We want to come together, Africans all over the world, as Garvey used to do, and plot our way out of this situation. So to work at my school, you cannot be sexually confused. Because that's not the energy you want for our children. I'm unapologetically African. The other rule, you must be married to an African, dating an African. You cannot be married to an alien trying to work at FDMG Academy. I want to make sure you clear that. Brothers and sisters, it's time for New Year's resolutions. And you need to make yours. This is the psychologist in me talking. Black people are suffering from race of depression that we haven't seen since the Great Depression. A lot of y'all going to the cigarettes, going to the alcohol, going to sex, going to shopping to try to placate your hurts. Face your demons, brothers and sisters. The whole purpose of therapy is to force you to face yourself. Kill the devil that's terrorizing your happiness so you can live in paradise. Do you know why people go to therapy? Why do people pay $200 or $300 an hour to listen to a stranger? To have a stranger listen to them? Because most people don't have friends they can trust enough to listen to their privations. You go to therapy for three reasons. To pay somebody to listen without interrupting. To pay them to not judge you. And to promise not to share your secrets. That's what therapy is. I'm going to give you $200 an hour to listen without interrupting me, to not judge me for the sins I've committed, and to not tell nobody about what I shared with you today. Do you know what that definition equals? That's a friend. That's what a friend is supposed to do. But so many of us don't have friends. We suffer in silence. So what I want you all to focus on in 2016, family. Some of you got brothers you ain't spoke to in years. Reach out before it's too late. Some of you got sisters, mothers and fathers, cousins and nieces, friends from high school. Squash the beef. It ain't worth it. To forgive is to lighten your burden. If you cannot forgive, you will not be forgiven. We need to understand that. Black women, you have to come together because you need each other. Black women might be suffering more than black men. Most of us got a brother we can go holler at, but a lot of sisters, they got another sister they can trust enough to listen without judgment, not interrupt, and promise not to repeat. See, the difference between beefs between brothers and beefs between sisters is that with brothers, our beefs and conflicts with one another have a time limit. If me and Killer Mike got an issue, 3 years from now, we see each other, we pound up, we squash, the issue over. If me and David got an issue 5 years from now, he took my girlfriend, hypothetically. Of course he didn't, I'm making this up. Okay? Guess what? We see each other, we squash it up, it's over. That's men. Black men got this thing with us where we grow out of it. But black women, I don't think you have that. Sisters will keep their peace for the rest of their life. A black woman had a fight in sixth grade, you can run into that sister at 60. And you put shea butter on your face because it's time to finish, but we start. 5 years. We're going to rap in a minute. because I know you brought your merchandise. David got his God Box. I don't want you leaving until you get a copy of that album, The God Box by David Banner. You're not leaving without that. We got vendors in the back. You want to support them. I don't want you in my picture line or book signing line if you didn't buy something from one of these vendors. I want them going home, pockets filled, merchandise sold out.